my purpose here is to let you know about what I think is the amazing world of nature and what it could do for us. And I think there's so many opportunities that I see in terms of bringing my heritage and my cultural background and seeing these things with different eyes. And because my eyes come from Australia, and I do want to acknowledge that Australia is my home, but I have a strong connection to Asia because that's where I was born. And coming from Australia with the knowledge that I have and the education that I have, I see things with a different perspective. And that opens up a whole new load of opportunities that I can see that we can benefit from together. Even though my home is in Australia, but my birthplace was Vietnam, I think it's quite a privilege because I have perspectives from many different places. I've grown up here and I know the culture very well, but going to Asia, there's a certain appreciation for the simple life. And I think, especially in Australia, we're so distracted with everything in front of us, with TVs, iPads, iPhones, internet, all that sort of stuff. We are so removed from the natural environment. And when I go to Asia, they don't have a lot of the money. They don't have a lot of the technology. And so it goes back to the raw selves, the natural environment. And I see certain happiness in that rawity that you have with the natural environment as opposed to from here and there. And I think that perspective is actually really good. And I think the people also see me as one of them, whether it's Vietnam or Asia, because that's where I was born, but I've been overseas doing all this studying, training to bring back these perspectives, this technology to help them.
Now, I really believe that nature is going to help us be a better world. It's got all the answers that we need. And there's a famous saying from Hippocrates that food can be your medicine, but it can also be a poison. It depends on how you take it. Hands up if you drink coffee. Keep your hands up if you think it's good for you. Or hands up if you only drink it because you like to and you don't really care about the benefits or not. Well, it's great. We all have something in common. Now, coffee is the second most popular drink in the world, second only to water. There's 1.6 billion cups drank a day in the world. Last year, in December 2018, the British Medical Journal came out with a metadata review of all the coffee research that was produced. And what they concluded was that coffee is actually quite good for you, but only in moderation. We wanted to look at the brain effects. Now, your brains contain two different types of cells. One is neurons and the other one are astrocytes. So we looked at the astrocytes and we wanted to know what was actually occurring when we added coffee to it. And we know that coffee is a stimulant. And as you can see, most of them with the cells that don't have anything in it, it's at pretty normal levels. When we added coffee, spikes it up because it's stimulating that effect, and that's the stimulation you get from drinking coffee. We also looked at the effect on wound healing, which is quite new, and we're trying to develop this as something to use the waste as well. Now, the beans you don't want to use because that's stuff we'll drink. I mean, that's the stuff we'll roast to drink. But the rest of the stuff that's thrown away, like the pulp and the husk, if you can imagine, it's more than 50% of the actual fruit. We're throwing away 50% of 1.6 billion cups a day. That's a lot of waste, but it has potential to heal us in terms of superficial wounds.
Initially, when I started my research, it was really to go see the farmers and how they produce these products. But along the process, I saw the waste, and it was unexpected. I, as a scientist and a nature lover, I thought I'd be a lot more aware of it than that. And seeing all this waste, that's why I made it a determination of mine to see that others also see that waste through my eyes, my vision, my experiences, because most people wouldn't have the experience to actually go and pollinate their own orchids or you know, go to a farm where chocolate's made and see the process from the start to the end and the waste that's produced along the way. So for me, I feel very lucky to have been exposed to that, and I feel it as my obligation to share with the public the foods that we're eating, the waste that's also generated on the side that we don't see.
Now, the next plant that I have is Moringa oleifera. It's considered by the World Health Organization as a famine crop because it contains a whole load of nutrients and it can grow in a lot of different regions. So it turns out it's a subtropical, tropical plant that grows in nice warm climates, can grow almost anywhere, but it's ideally suited to places that are very high in malnutrition. And when we looked at it, it's got quite a bit of calcium in there, a plant-derived calcium. Now, why is that important? With calcium, the problem is it's usually associated with vitamin D because it helps with absorption. So even though the calcium's there, your body can't absorb it. And a lot of plants, they may have calcium, but they've got phytates or inhibitors that will actually stop you from absorbing it. Broccoli is actually really good in terms of its percentage of absorption. But the problem is it's very low amounts actually available. When we looked at moringa, it's also got about 30% absorption bioavailability, but it's got a lot more in terms of total calcium. This is a plant that could actually be something that we could look at in terms of diversifying our calcium intake. We also looked at its effect on cancer. So specifically, we looked at carcinoma cancer. So we looked at the leaf and the flower and everything else, and we found that it was actually reducing the growth of these cancer cells. Now, my last plant is my favourite, my personal favourite. This plant I discovered over 15 years ago, and it was by accident. I was walking the market. The first thing I do when I go to a country is I want to go visit the market, the farmer's market. I want to know what they're growing. I want to know what they use it for, and I want to try everything. And I saw this really red fruit, orange red fruit. I've never seen it before. And that's what it looks like on the inside. So it's usually found in the tropics. We looked at its anti-cancer activity. Now, these are melanoma cells, both melanoma, carcinoma, and breast cancer cells. And we found that different varieties from different regions was reducing cancer cells 60% growth. So it's not killing them, but it's reducing enough so it's not at 100%. We looked at apoptosis, which is one main way of cells dying, and we looked at morphologies and we dyed them with different stains to show the apoptosis. So we had FITSI and different stains that looked at different pathways of death. And we looked at scanning electron microscopes and TEM, so transmission electron microscopes. So we wanted to not only see the pathways that was dying, but also the morphology of how it was doing it through the cells. And I've also been working with University of Queensland, who specialise in cyclotides, and we know the function of these little proteins that actually go into the cells and how it works with breaking up different compounds and using it for different applications. So it's more the nanoparticle structures and micromorphology rather than what we can see with our eyes. So with a lot of the technologies, I mean, apoptosis is a very well-studied pathway. Looking at microscopy, it's also quite well studied. So we followed what a lot of others have found in terms of, or what others have used in terms of explaining why things happen the way they do. Now, the seed had even more bioactivity. We're talking about 90 to 95% effectiveness. And when we looked at the mechanism, we were finding it was even more effective than the arrow in eating the cells from the inside out so that it was almost nothing left. Now, I'd like us to take a moment to reflect on the three plants that I've shown you. They're not the only plants that are available, and I really believe that the plants are our medicine. And there's so much potential within them. And as I've shown you, a lot of these plants, we take it for granted just, you know, that it tastes good, it smells nice, and we'll just drink it. But the potentials behind it, the medicines behind it are huge. I believe that in order to make a difference, the first step is believing it yourself, making those steps and making it believable to others. And by word of mouth and by people looking at you and seeing your practices, they can see how easy it is and they can take on board and amplify that through their networks. We're only separated by, 6 degrees of freedom. If I do something really well, I will tell 6 people. And those 6 people will tell their 6 people. And through the power of networking, I think that would be making a much better difference than me just doing my own keeping a secret.